sense of who the audience is. So, could you raise your hand if you are a school teacher? Okay. What if you are a mathematician or a math faculty member? What about people who are students here at this university? What about people who are just plain citizens come to hear about the Common Birthday Standard? Okay. And is there anybody I didn't categorize yet? Principal, okay. Great, it's nice to have a diverse group of people. I'm really sort of heartened to see such a large group of people coming here about what has to be like an imperative before state standards. And I'm worried that I won't live up to your expectations, that you will in fact find me boring. So, just in case that happens, I'll try and be as amusing as I can talking about standards. But just in case I fail, I've given you a little math problem to think about. Why is 5/3 equal to 5 divided by 3? And you'll notice I call this a quiz. I think I told you this all. So if you're happy to write the end of the talk. I want you to think about this, and you know, as I say, you get more fun out. Some people might think, well, like, isn't that what you mean by 5/3? Isn't it true by definition? So, of course, being a mathematician, I need to give you my definition of 5/3 and my definition of 5 divided by 3. And in my mind, they're not identically the same object, and so there's something to do here. So what do I mean by 5/3? If I take the number line and divide each unit interval into 3 pieces, then I call each of one of those pieces 1/3. And then if I take 5 of them and line them up next to each other, I get to the point on the number line 5/3. This is what I mean by 5/3. Okay, got that? What do I mean by 5 divided by 3? Well, in my mind, division is really just a subsidiary operation for multiplication. So by definition, 32 divided by 8 is whatever you have to multiply, it's the number that makes 32 when you multiply it by 8. That's what 32 divided by 8 is. 4. And so it same goes for 5 divided by 3. What I mean by 5 divided by 3 is it's whatever number that if you multiply it by 3, you get 5. So my question, just to emphasize it, is there's 5/3. Why is 3 times that equal to 5? And when I say why, I don't want you to just show me that it's true. There's a difference between showing that something is true and explaining why it's true. So, you could just take that interval, put it together 3 times, and say, look, I get 5. So yeah, alright. And you can check this is right. You can count the number of thirds. What I'd like you to do is explain why this works. And in particular, one way to test whether you have an explanation of why it works is whether it works for other fractions. So the secret sort of bonus question behind this quiz question is why, in general, for any A and B whole numbers, is A divided B not equal to 0? Is A over B, the fraction A over B, equal to A divided by B? And as you're thinking about this, as any sort of correct answer will be acceptable. You'll leave the lecture with full points, but you get more points if you give an answer which is the sort of answer that you might expect a fifth grader to be able to give. Okay? So does everybody feel like they understand the question now? Well, is it everybody who wants to work on it? They all feel they understand the question? Because I'm going to leave it now. I'll come back to it at the end, and I'll give one possible practice. So for the rest of the lecture, I'm going to talk about standards try and explain to you this remarkable moment in history that we're at, where we seem to be moving towards something that I think I didn't dream of as being possible 3 years ago, namely common standards for mathematics. And just to sort of remind ourselves of the context, I want to sort of give you a little bit of background, history, context for the whole standards movement in this country and how we got here. A lot of people mark the beginning of the modern era of worrying about mathematics. And by the way, this country spends its entire existence worrying about mathematics education. You know, you may have figured out by now that although I am an American citizen, I wasn't born in this country. I was born in Australia, where the sort of standard phrase is no worries. And so, whereas in sometimes I feel like here we like to worry about things a lot. And so here's the first sort of famous report in 1983 called The Nation at Risk, which sounded the alarm for the sort of recent wave of worry about mathematics education. And the introduction to the report had this famous quote: if an unfriendly foreign power had attempted to impose on America the mediocre educational performance that exists today, you might well have viewed it as an act of war. And that sort of tone of language and has been prevalent ever since. This report was called The Nation at Risk. We've had a whole bunch of other reports since then. Before it's too late. That was the Glenn Commission report, I think, at the end of the Clinton presidency. Then more recently, we had a report during the Bush presidency called Rising Above the Gathering Storm. But then there's been an update of that report just this year called Approaching Category 5, or something like that. Sometimes wonder how far you can ramp this rhetoric up before, you know, sooner or later there'll have to be a report called Preparing the Levy, so something like that. Whatever. Anyway, So there's been a lot of anxiety and discussion, debate, argument, wars, not this sort of war, but math wars, but not much progress. So this report came out in 1983. In 1997, Bill Schmidt came out with a report called The Splintered Vision. So an important sort of milestone in all of this was in 1995, there was the third International Mathematics and Science Study, TIMSS, which was a comparison of something on the order of 45 countries. Kids were given math tests, particularly math and science, and the report was saying 5 different care performance. And you've probably seen these graphics of like US being down there somewhere. Mind you, by the way, if you pay attention to these graphics, sometimes the US is perfectly in decent position. That's not the top. There's only one thing actually that's really important. But so, you know, I mean, it's not always gloomy news, but certainly the media, the high ground is always emphasized with gloomy news. And this is the report where the phrase mile wide, inch deep was coined. And what he's saying here, I'll leave this out, I won't do any more quote reading after this, but this one, I think, is important in, you'll see when we get to the Common Core. First, they said there's no one at the helm of mathematics and science education in the US. No single coherent vision of how to educate today's children dominates US educational practice. And then it says these splintered visions produce unfocused curriculum textbooks that emphasize familiarity with many topics rather than concentrated attention to a few, and likely lower the academic performance of students in 10 years in such a learning environment. Apparently, we can learn textbooks and teach them out a mile wide and in the speech. So that's the metaphor that's dominated our discourse ever since then, this idea that we spend a lot of, cover a lot of different things, but nothing in there. And that's the problem that the Common Core was trying to solve. Why is this? mile wide Indian curriculum. It's not like it's anybody's fault, particularly. It's a result of the system that we have. And an important characteristic of the U.S. educational system, which is not present in most other countries, is this fierce attachment to local control over education, over lots of things, but in particular over education. Local control means that every state, until some of four at least, had its own set of standards to make decisions about mathematics education. It was only recently that they even got aggregated at the state level. Many decisions even today, maybe not about standards, but about textbooks, for example, are made at the school district or even the school. So this country has 13,506 school districts. I just put up the map of Arizona's school district. The map of California's school district probably looks a lot more impressive, or scary, depending on your point of view. And so local control is partly what is the result of in this sort of diversity of approaches and diversity of curriculum. Of course, we value diversity, right? We think that having lots of different ideas is a good thing, and often it is. But at least in education, it has also resulted in this splintered vision that Bill Schmidt's talking about. So the big problem is how to retain creativity, how to find some sort of common purpose so that people can share ideas, so that innovation sort of gets stuck at the school district level or on the screen. So that 1983 report that I was talking about launched a period of reform in mathematics education and a period of thinking about state standards. And the first big move in this was from the National Council of Teachers of Mathematics, who did something really incredibly gutsy. So, as I say, in this country, you can't have the federal government or even state governments to start dictating things to schools. At least, certainly, that was not politically possible in the 80s. And so, unlike other countries where curriculum and standards often are decided at the government level, in this country, it was an organization of teachers themselves, the National Council of Teachers of Mathematics, which took charge of the situation. And they came out in 1989 with a set of standards for mathematics education. Those standards were not detailed or specific necessarily prescriptions at the grade level for exactly what to teach, but they were more of a vision. They were intended as a guiding document that would inform people's thinking about curriculum, about mathematics education. In California, this led to, in the early 90s, a development of a framework based on the NCTM standards. I think probably people hoped that this would happen in lots of states. States would start writing their own standards following the NCTM standards. Some did. Some, like California, experienced a counter-revolution against the NCTM standards. So in California, I don't know how many people here are veterans of the California math course. It's a wonderful story, but not wonderful, it's an interesting story. But certainly, we didn't have unity in common purpose. We had overthrow of the California framework, and then we had the California standards. And then in response to this and other movements around the country, the NCTM came up with a revision of their standards in 2000, in fact, this graphic which would have a favorite. Okay, so it didn't quite work out necessarily as intended, but still it was a start. It was the beginning of the modern era of standards and based reform. I want to give you a little bit of a sense understand a bit of context for why the Common Core ended up where it ended up. Part of that requires getting a bit of an understanding for the difference between the NCTM standards and all of the standards that states are writing themselves, and to understand why that was true. So this is, I'm not, obviously not expecting you to read this page, it's just a graphic, but I want to draw your attention to some features of it. This is a page from the 2000 NCTM Principles and Standards School of Mathematics. Number and operations. Notice it's grades 6 through 8. And then there are some bullets. About 14 of them. If a standard is a thing in a standards document with a bullet next to it, these are the standards in the NCTM standards for grades 6 through 8, number and operations. 14 bullets. Of course, they didn't leave it at that. These 14 bullets are followed by 7 pages of narrative description of how this all fits together and what it all means. But that was the NCTM vision, sort of a short number of bullets and then some narrative explanation. That seems like a good recipe for focus for theorists. When states started writing their own standards, they came up with something like this. So this is a randomly chosen page from a randomly chosen state which happened to have access to its standards. And this is completely typical. I'm not going to criticize. I'm pointing your attention to the difference. So notice here, again, you can't read the standard itself. We're going to use just grade 6 now. It's the same domain, number and operations. Just grade 6. And then it says, strand 1. Right, so anybody who's actually tried to read through the state standards document, how many people here have actually tried to write strand from California? Doesn't that strike terror into your heart? That phrase, strand 1. Because what does that tell you? There's a strand 2. And there's a strand 3. And we're still only in grade 6. And we're still only in number and operations. These are like grade 8 and 4. And so, and then there's a bunch of, okay, these bullets are not bullets, they're here, performance objectives. So anyway. So this is just grade 6, strand 1, number and operations. So just to give you a sense of the difference between these two, the NCTM standards, as I say, had 14 bullets. For all of grade 6 through 8, 7 pages of narrative, just for this number and operations domain. The state has 82, if you count the performance objectives, 82 standards for number and operations in grade 6 alone, and no pages of narrative. Okay, and like any other standards document, it's very and I feel bad about that because I don't want but anyway. So you know, it's not like it was anybody's fault that the standards somehow evolved this way. There are all sorts of pressures on the country during the period that states were writing their own standards. Standards-based accountability, high-stakes assessment for students. When a state adopts a set of standards, it's not like the NCTM, they can just say, okay, here's what we think. States are accountable for what they pass as standards. They're often legally accountable. So in Minnesota, for example, the state standards is a legal document. It's an act of the legislature. It gets written into the legislative record of the state standards document. So once that becomes that sort of legal document, people can sue you on the basis of it, right? And so standards by necessity, just because of these pressures of assessment, accountability, having to define in some sort of legal sense what the state was responsible for teaching the students, they had to be these much more detailed bulletin lists. And I'll come back a little bit later in the talk to why that's a problem and why that was a tension in the writing of the Common Core, because we couldn't escape from that any more than state standards right was trying to do. And so, state standards, although they were written either in response to or in response against the NCTM standards, did not achieve this unity of purpose that I think people have hoped for with the beginning of the standards movement. And here's just a beautiful example of that. This is a study that was done by the Center for the Study of Mathematics curriculum of various different states, looking at their standards and figuring out where in that state's standards are children required to be fluent in addition to fraction of fraction grade. Go to grade 1, grade 7. This is what mile-wide inch meat looks like. This is what lettuce, let's say, we're in now. And maybe you're going to look at this and say, okay, I don't believe those two states in grade 1. That's a coding error. That's a misinterpretation. Someone can't really affect codes in grade 1. We can throw out the outline. I don't care. Throw out the grade 7 and grade 6. We've still got three solid grade levels, 3rd through 5th. Still a very broad band where kids are expected to be fluent in addition to subtraction and fractions. That's just a remarkable degree of incoherence in the natural grid. Okay, so that's sort of the background against which the Common Core State Standards came along. And I remember going to a talk in like late 2008, I think it was actually the joint lab meeting in January 2009, where Bill Smith, who's the guy who did that mile-wide inch-deep product that I was mentioning earlier, got up and said, he presented, this is not his research, but anyway, he had a research like this, just shows this incredible sort of lack of coherence in the curriculum. And he said, we need common sense. And I went up to him afterwards and said to that, well, sure, I mean, okay, that's true, but that's going to happen, right? I mean, in March of 2009, I was asked to sign up to the Common Core State Standards. So I wanted to just sort of give you that background, that this was a moment where I think, you know, everybody knew this had to happen, nobody believed it could happen, and to this day I don't quite know why it did, to be honest. So it's a remarkable moment. It's a moment of incredible opportunity for all of us to do something comprehensive and good about what your responsibility is at the end, after you take the quiz, that you're working on. So the Common Core State Standards started in the development of Common Core State Standards started in this, March or April of 2009. And I'll just run through very briefly what the process was. And then I want to tell you a little bit about the standards themselves. So, remarkably, or maybe just necessarily, because of the way things work in this country, this was not an effort led by the federal government. It was an effort led by the states, two organizations of states, the National Government Association and the Council of Chief State School Officers. How many people had heard of these either of these organizations in 2009? I'm not raising my hand. I had not heard of either of these organizations. How many people have heard of them now? Okay. So, like, obscure organizations, right? What are they? Who are these people? Well, they're like, it's less like the National Governors Association, which is a club of state governors. All governors are members of this association. At meetings, they talk about governor stuff. And then the Council of Chief State School Officers is the club of, I don't know, who's the superintendent of public education in California. This is part of those people. They go together and they say, well, no. They sort of proposed to their membership this idea of having common standards. And they got an overwhelmingly positive reaction, one that I think surprised the guests. They got 48 states to sign on to agree to develop these standards. Two states stood apart. Okay. Quiz. In 2009, two states. Sorry? Texas is correct. Alaska. Thank you. Yeah. Texas and Alaska did not sign on to this. The other 48 states did. They chose a very different process for standards writing than the states have used. So I don't know, how many people here I guess California really didn't do much there already after 1993. But, or framework. Or efforts to develop some sort of framework for your school district. It's like a bunch of people get together in a room and you have all sorts of boards, a lot of speech, and everybody starts talking and training. Right? It's sort of, the school there are described as a result of some negotiations. They chose a design process. They said, okay, let's design these standards. That commissioned a three-person design team. I was the, created together, but I was the person who actually resolved the speech if there were any. And then a very, very large working team of teachers, mathematicians, educators, administrators, that was sort of submitting work to us that we would then find process and back to them for critique and review. So there was a sort of, it was a bit like an architectural firm that's being asked to build a building. Of course, you have lots and lots of clients, and like these people want this, like they want an empty car down here, and I want bathrooms over there, and I want open air offices with glass windows. And you have all these different requirements. The architectural firm's job is to design something that works as a building, that respects the laws of gravity, and the laws of physics, and that responds in as far as it's possible to this diverse array of concerns and wishes, desires, and supplies. And that's, I think, the way we operate. We try to respond as much as we could to what this team of working team wanted. We commissioned progressions from them, documents that were described in narrative form, how mathematics would flow across grade levels. And then we tried to sort of figure out a design that worked for all those systems. We had various mandates from the governors and the chiefs. We were writing standards that would make students college and career ready. That was a phrase that we were not contractually committed to question. College and career ready was like one word, you know. And so it was taken as a given that meant something, that being both ready for college and career was somehow, there was some sort of central core of knowledge that students needed. Well, whether they were going on to Harvard or whether they were going on to a trade school. So we committed to that. That was a mandate that we were writing college and career ready standards. They had to be internationally benchmarked. We had to address this mile-wide industry problem. We had to address this problem that we weren't keeping up with other countries. And they had to be research-based. As I said, they were based on progressions that were submitted by a design work team. So the progressions were documents that were narrative descriptions of how mathematics flows across grade levels. And then we went through this whole process of getting feedback, more feedback. That year, and then we finished in the summer of 2010, and the state celebrated the decision. So when we started doing this work, we thought, gee, you know, like, wouldn't it be neat if 10 states adopted these standards? Wouldn't it be great if 20 states adopted the standards? Wouldn't it be, like, unbelievable, like, beyond our wildest dreams if 30 states adopted the standards? So, 45 states have adopted the Common Core State Standards. It's just truly a remarkable one. 46 have adopted. There was mathematics standards that we declared with their class standards. There's one state which adopted the English Standard Class Standards. Anyway, so a really sort of remarkable moment. The coming together, such as I've never seen before in sort of 20 years of math books and ideas about space. Okay. And we looked at, this is just sort of a list of all the sources we considered. I want to point out one of these things, which is the structure of the subject. I'm going to come back to that. That was something that was very important to us, was to think about standards as having to try and keep a track of the full perspective of the structure of mathematics and stuff. So let me talk a little bit now about the principles were focused for coherence and understanding. I'll just talk a little bit about all of them. I don't want to go into too much detail about the standards, but I want to give you some sense of flavor of them. I'm sure some of you are probably studying them quite carefully, but so I don't want to dig too deeply into them. But I want to talk first about what we mean by focus. And what we mean by focus simply is getting rid of mild light entry. And mild light entry came about partly because of what I call this matrix mentality. So a lot of you are probably used to thinking of mathematics, especially you know, if you're in the school system, if you're in K-12, if you're a teacher or an administrator, just having a number of strands. Number of operations, geometry, data, algebra and functions, maybe there's a reasoning strand in your state standards, there was in Arizona. But the definition of a strand is that it goes all the way from kindergarten to 12th grade. So you have this matrix, four or five strands, kindergarten, first grade, second grade, third grade, and 12th grade. So like what do you do if you're a mathematician or a math teacher when you see a nice big empty matrix? You want to write. Why don't we get a foot for algebra and functions in second grade? Yeah, you didn't need it. But no, it's just like I did, you have to check off every little square in the box. You got like, that's not rolled in, like, you know, where because we're accountable for this. I just leave an area blank. I don't know, you know, if someone had invented the idea of writing intentionally left blank in state standards. Maybe we wouldn't have had this problem. It sounds stupid, right? I mean, like, of course, that's not the only cause of the problem. But the sort of need to figure, to answer the question, what are you doing about algebra and functions in second grade, drove a lot of checkbox thinking about standards curriculum and assessment. So, I mean, you didn't have time to focus on what you really wanted to be doing in second grade, which is teaching kids how to add and subtract. So the point of the design here, not a whole lot different from strands, but the big difference is we call these domains. The big difference is they have a beginning and an end. They don't go all the way from kindergarten to 12th grade. There's stuff that stops happening in 5th grade and 8th grade, there's stuff that starts happening in 6th grade. There are fewer things per grade level. Focus does not mean doing less overall, it means doing fewer topics per grade level. In each grade level, you focus on what's important at that grade level in order to prepare for something else possibly different in the next grade. You have time to finish what you begin, and you have time to focus on what happens. So this, I think, is the greatest step forward, the greatest shift in the experience. And really, we were thinking of teachers when we did this. I mean, if you're a teacher, you know what the problems are in your grade level. And you know that you don't have time to sort of finish what's really important to the people in the grade level, because there's some assessment of teachers which is going to have a problem about, I don't know, finding the median of a five-element set. Never mind that the median, like, using a median for a set of five elements might stupid be for them possibly too. Right. You wanted to describe the set, you know the sort of problem I'm talking about, right? Consider the set 1, 1, 1, 2, 9. That's I mean, the purpose of me, I'm getting off your rant, the purpose of mean median mode is to try to give you some way of describing, in some sort of summary numbers, a complex data set. So you're talking about some huge data set that you can't, you know, that you can't describe directly. But how do you describe the set 1, 1, 1, 2, 9? You could probably just say, 3 1s are 2 and a 9. I mean, you know, you don't need. You don't need to mean the median, okay, right. Turn the rank off. But those are the sort of problems that made their way into the curriculum, to see your regulation on its number operation. This is geometry, this measurement of data. This is also where it's building the foundation for number of operations. Okay, fine. By the time you get to grade six, you mentioned sometimes tied all your knowledge of number of operations together into a unified concept of the number system. So you've done all that, you've been there, doesn't even learn how to add fractions anymore because you did that. Okay, I'm describing an idea as well, but yeah. And then you can make ways of thinking about algebra, beginnings of algebra, learning to work with expressions and equations. You can start thinking about statistics and probability and geometry in a more sort of in-depth way. So that's what's meant by approaches. Let me skip this slide. So approaches in high school, to say a very brief word about it, means something a little bit different. It means not so much reducing the number of topics per grade level as trying to synthesize things, pull things together under unified themes, so that you don't have to memorize every single form of the equation for a line as some separate, magically different piece that has nothing to do with any of the other forms. But you have an overarching sort of coherent understanding of slope that enables you to see all these forms. Let me talk a little bit about coherence. We're going to tell you the story of the Greek germ. So imagine you go into an antique store and you buy a very old, valuable Greek germ. You can tell. And then, you know, the guy says, okay, you've settled the deal, you pay the price, he says, do you want me to ship it to you? You say yes. He gets a hammer, smashes it into 1,000 pieces, and says, I'll send you a piece every day in an envelope for the next year, and you'll, 3 years, and you'll be fine, you know. Don't worry, you get all the pieces, they'll all fit together again, you know, and you'll have your background cover. The coverage is sort of somehow, you know, that's what you always have to do with the birthday, like the cover the brick. Do every little thing. And the idea that you can shatter a subject into 1,000 pieces and still have the subject is absurd. This is what standards for the Greek germ look like. In some sense, of course, it's all there. Put the puzzle back together again, you've got it all. But nobody can see the structure of the subject when it's broken into standards. Okay? Tough life for standards writers, because that's what we have to do, break it into standards. Like, we didn't have any choice about that. Like, we could. Sometimes I think it would have been nice if we could have just written, one standard, right? New mathematics. We were not at liberty to do that. So we had to, in some sense, come up with this atomizing of the subject in the pieces. At the same time, as trying to resist the effects of that atomizing, and trying to retain the coherence. And so we tried various ways of doing that. And this design around progressions is one of them. The way progressions fit together is another of them. So in the common core state standards, there are various levels of hierarchy, the domains being the top level, that matter for the structure of the standard. In other words, the headings have some meaning. The way they fit together, the wording within them has meaning in terms of the structure of the standard. I won't say any more about this. I mean, sometimes when I talk about the standard, I go into much more detail. If you want, you can go to my blog, commoncoretools.me, and read my essay on the, you know, it's got the Grecian verb picture at the beginning of it, and this explains more detail. So talk about what we mean by focus. Talk about what we mean by coherence. I want to say a little bit about understanding. That was a big battle for us to write standards that had the word understanding in them. If you've ever dealt with assessment people, or if you are one yourself, you know that this is a sort of, this divine standard that says, understand the meaning would be equal to sign. Actually, there is such a standard in grade 2, grade 1. And people say, we can't use that word. You say, what word? Equals? Sign? No! The word you cannot use is the word understand. I think how remarkable that is. You're writing expectations for what you want your children to come away from school with. and you're allowed to use the word understand. We were that now, so we didn't use the word understand, but at one point we thought we'd get ourselves teachers. What part of understand do you not understand? But the other way in which we tried to codify what I think of as sort of not just knowing the math, but being able to do the math, being able to know what you're doing, being able to sort of understand what you're doing, is these sense of mathematical facts. So there are contents here, which is what I've been talking about so far. And then there are these standards for mathematical practice, which are, I won't go through them, they're descriptions of just what you want to see happening when you see kids in your classroom doing mathematics. They're descriptions of how you want them to be thinking, what sort of habits of mind you want them to have. So these standards really sort of live within the content standards. They should be integrated into the content standards. Every time you see kids doing mathematics, you should be thinking about what sort of practice they're exhibiting. The practice standards, by the way, for a little bit of, I sometimes worry about them. Actually, people love them by and large. Sometimes I worry that people love them a bit because I think you begin to see, guess what, maybe, you know, right, all the content standards down here, you know, all the practice standards out here, content standards across here. And people wanting to fill in the matrices. And that somehow gives me the shivers. Not every practice standard is relevant at every given time in the curriculum. There are some content areas that demand certain ones. There are other content areas which you really, quite honestly, you just want to learn about. I mean, mathematics is not like a uniform substance. It's not like peanut butter smeared all over a sandwich. It's more like you've reached learn. It has a structure. It has parts of it that are very detailed, parts of it that are blank. It has an intricate structure that you have to be able to see both at the grand level, shape of the bars, and at the detailed story level, and you have to be sort of using your brain all the time and looking at it. Okay, so, this is just a metaphor, I guess. This is actually a task that we have in the illustrative mathematics project that's putting up the sample task in illustrative standards. It's a task, and I haven't put the words for this task. The task basically says, paper clip is about 4 centimeters long, it's a little over 4 centimeters long. How many of these paper clips did you make with 100 meters of wire? That's the task. So what I like about it, it's fairly simple. Although I think probably most people would find it quite difficult. Part of what they would find difficult is you didn't tell them to do anything. I just asked them a question. What I like about it is, to me, it captures, what do we want kids to know 10 years after they leave high school? Okay, some of them will be physicists and mathematicians, and they probably still know all the algebra. Some will just be like, I don't know, people slaving away in a paperclip. And you want them to have the habit of looking at things mathematically. So you see, look at this, first you just see a paperclip, right? Well, then you notice that maybe it was actually a measurement scale along the bottom, and I guess that must be the 4 centimeters that we were talking about. But in particular, you want them to see structure in this object. What structures do you want people to see in this paperclip? Circle, semicircle, straight lines. When you start looking carefully, you realize you can actually figure out the length of the straight pieces, the length of the semicircle. Oh, I have to remember the formula for the circumference of the circle. Oh, I can figure out the length of this paperclip. Then you start thinking, well, hang on, am I going to measure the inside wing or the outside wing? They're not the same. So it somehow pulls in lots of really fairly simple mathematics you learn in middle school. But it's up to you to pull it in. And so what practice standards are about, partly, is simply producing kids who have an inclination to use the mathematics they know. So that's sort of my very brief tour of the standards. There's a lot of work going on right now. We're trying to understand the digital space and doing different things. Some people, I think, are sort of acting as if the standard is some sort of magic wand, which is going to solve a lot of problems. They're not. All the standards do is they do clear the air a little bit in the math wars. I hope we're past the math wars now. I think they managed to sort of find a lot of positions that were either some sort of third way, science better out of action in the math wars, or we had some sort of compromise, or we just made a decision and said get over it. I mean, all of those things happen in very different parts of the standards. But I think what the common standards do is move us beyond all that to a point where we can actually start working together. And it's the word common that I really want to focus on here. I don't think we as a nation are used to thinking about the power that comes from having a common purpose. We're so used to valuing diversity, so used to valuing multiple different points of view, so used to respecting everybody's point of view. Well, like I said, I grew up in a square there. Out there, the arguments that we had around the table were not about respecting everybody. You had to really make the case. But anyway, so now we have a sort of something we can base our action on and know that what we figure out in our classroom is not just applicable in our classroom, but in our school district, not just in our school district, but in our state, not just in our state, but to a teacher in the outside of the country. And that's by focusing on the details of some shared set of understandings that we can really provide great power. So of course, that's not going to happen unless you all do that. I mean, all we did was write standards. By themselves, they're nothing. It's the actions that we now take, sort of in common, in concert, that will help us some. That give us the opportunity to actually do something with improving mathematics education. That's all I had to say. There was something else I wanted to do.
Cool.
Yes, right. Yeah, that's right. Why is 5/3 equal 5/5? I think that's not my answer. Does anybody have an answer?
Can you answer?
Yeah.
Because I would get the multiply 5/3 by 5.
Okay. Why? Yes?
How does G5 in the fraction of 15/3 by 5?
5/3 is not 15. Oh, why? It's 15/3. Okay. Why is 5 equal to 15/3? Oh, no, no, this answer, yeah.
What about running out as 5 times 1/3?
Oh, you're telling me that you think 5/3 is 5 times 1/3. That's the way I define it. I can live with that, though. I can live with that. I repeatedly add 1/3 to it 5 times. Multiplication, repeated division, 5/3 is 5 times. Okay.
So what do you think about it as?
How does it help you see that it's 5 divided by 3? Yes, over here.
Well, 5 divided by 3 is just a different way to say 5/3. So 5/3 is identical.
Okay, that's a very mathematical move you made just there. Like, you're trying to subvert the whole view. You say, oh, that's just my definition of 5/3. But I gave you definitions at the beginning that didn't allow you to just say they mean the same thing by definition. Good move, though. Yeah. Anybody else?
If you take those 5/3 that you had put up on the W line before, you just put one of them in the first slot in each of the successive five, then multiplying that by 3 would fill out every five.
You mean like this? So I take the 5/3. Hey, I did. This is not a setup. I take those 5/3. I put one in each of the five. So that's a general thing, right? It works with A over B, because I have A, B, and I'm trying to say, well, that's A divided by B. So I always have exactly the right number of B's, thirds in this case, to put one in each slot. And then, how many of those do I need to replicate to fill out the whole number 9? Well, as many as there are, like, but depends what the size of, if it's thirds, I need two more. I need three altogether. Mm-hmm. But if it was beasts, I need B of them. So this is a sort of visual proof that 3 times 5/3 is 5. That if you think about the step you took at each stage, works with A and B, works with any numbers A and B as well as 5 and 3. Full marks for that man. And I don't think you have a can't fit of a better time or place to stop, so I'll stop.
Thank Bill for a very entertaining, if dull, talk. And entertain any questions from the audience, except for what the answer to this question was, because you've answered that one already. Any other questions from the audience?
Grade level benchmarks?
Benchmarks.
The standards describe what kids should understand and be able to do at each grade level. Beyond that, I don't know what you mean by benchmarks. I mean, the standards themselves, I guess, are the benchmarks.
I guess the question is, the standards are for individuals, or are they for, say, a class or a, because teachers get evaluated and assessed the whole class, not just the individuals in the class.
Yeah, this is what I meant when I said there's still a lot of work to be done. I mean, standards by themselves, they're sort of like the chart in a doctor's office, the growth chart, that sort of is some sense where your child should be at a certain age. Well, nobody expects the child is exactly going to be there at that age, right? Some kids are shorter, some kids are taller. The growth chart is a reference point that you can use, and what's useful about it is everybody is using the same reference point. Intelligent use of that reference point is another matter, and we suffer a lot in our education system from unintelligent use of standards. In particular, one size fits all kids should be on the same page the same day of the year. We know that's not real life. So how the standards get used is, I think, that's implementation, that's thinking about curriculum, that's thinking about assessment, that's thinking about teacher evaluation. That all has to be done well rather than badly. The advantage that you have with common standards is that if you look around the country, somebody will be doing it well, somebody will be doing it badly, and because they're using the same set of standards, the people who are doing it well can be emulated, and we can maybe learn how to do it well. So I have an answer to you. The answer is no, they don't come with all that apparatus. That's really up to states implement, or even school districts in their implementations, to develop the usual apparatus that sort of surrounds standards.